This is the story of one of the longest and unlikeliest bridges ever completed. It was built over a solid decade, fashioned to last 1,000 years, spanning from the soft old Blue Ridge Mountains of Virginia to the severe Himalayas of western Nepal. This is a bridge made of tiny paint strokes, tortured landscapes, shock and grief and prayer and celebration. The bridge is a large painting. It's by American artist Jane Lillian Vance. It traveled from her home in Virginia to a small town in the Himalayas, and it's a symbol of a long collaboration between Vance and a prominent Tibetan Buddhist Lama. Its arrival in his village in 2007 was the reason for a two-day festival and cultural exchange. Jane Vance's painting arrived at a time of transition for the village. Even with the arrival of roads and running water and electricity, survival of the people there still depends on the success of crops and the availability of food and water. Jane Vance is the first Westerner and the first female to create such a work, and she did so with the official blessing of Tibetan spiritual leader His Holiness the Dalai Lama. Vance lives and paints and teaches in Blacksburg, Virginia, a college town in the Blue Ridge Mountains. These gentle mountains serve as inspiration for Vance, and their plants and animals inform her work. Blacksburg is also home to Virginia Tech University, where Vance teaches a course called the Creative Process.
Let me show you the difference between what modernists have tried to trick Americans into believing about art and what I want to clarify you can know art can do.
Just as the film team prepared to travel to Nepal, Virginia Tech was thrust into the national spotlight. On the morning of April 16, 2007, a student named Cho Sung-hui opened fire. He killed 32 people and then turned the gun on himself in the worst school shooting in history. Like everyone in the community, Vance and her students were deeply affected by the event, as was the Lama in faraway Nepal. This is the story of friendship, extreme risk, teamwork, and long perseverance, of crossing oceans and rivers and cultures for the high privilege of being the bearers of a gift for the village. The subject of Jane Vance's painting is Amchi Tsampa Ngawang Lama. Tsampa lives in the small western Nepali village of Jomsom. The word Amchi means doctor, and Tsampa is a living encyclopedia of traditional medicine and a concentrated master of endangered knowledge and skills, chief among them healing the physically sick and the heartbroken. He's highly respected for his years of service to the people of his region. Tsampa's a 10th-generation healer, a village leader, a farmer, a conservationist, woodblock carver, equine veterinarian, women's advocate, and settler of disputes. Tsampa's root teacher was his late father, Amchi Tinley Palwar Lama. He's remembered locally as a miraculously accomplished man who trained throughout his life to prepare for his conscious death. And Tsampa's son, Sewang, is already in intensive training to maintain these many ancient branches of knowledge, which all converge in his father.
Amchi's knowledge or tradition knowledge, which is inherited by the Amchi, they are very important in this respect, number one. Then number two, I would say that they are using the local resources from long time. And those local resources, those knowledge must be conserved and inherited from one generation to another one.
As a traditional doctor, Tsampa is a skilled botanist. He collects his own wild, rare plants and prepares them with specially alchemized metals and minerals and mud. And Amchi holds onto your wrist like a flute and hears with precision the sluggish or the healthy pulse of your internal organs. The medicines he prescribes encourage balance. If your spleen is weak, its function should reawaken. If your heart is anxious, it should regain composure.
Not bad.
Amchi knowledge from Tibet is partly about Himalayan ingredients. That's true. We may not grow the same plants that are required in certain old recipes that an Amchi learns. in the mountains of Nepal. But Amchi knowledge is also the faith that things grow back, and that in the mix in this world, you can find the right combination for healing.
Because of Tsampa's knowledge and social standing, the film crew from Virginia had access to solemn rituals and artisans' workshops and trekked into remote and restricted territory. That included the site of a nearly inaccessible cave, home to recently discovered ancient Buddhist paintings. Vance's arrival at the Cave of the Snow Leopard was a culmination of many years of studying Buddhist art from Sri Lanka to Nepal, and led to a surprising theory about its origin. Jane Lillian Vance was born in North Carolina in 1958, the youngest child in a conservative family of bankers and ministers. No one in her family had ever traveled to Asia, and no one painted. But by the time she entered kindergarten, Vance knew she was an artist. And she did travel, beginning her study of Nepali and Tibetan art in the mid-1980s. By 1990, prominent photojournalist Thomas Kelly saw photographs of Vance's paintings and suggested that she seek out Tsampa Ngawang. "Something in your paintings," the photographer told Vance, "reminds me of this lama's mind." Vance made many trips over the years to visit Tsampa and his family in their small village. By summer of 2001, Tsampa Ngawang had flown to the mountains of southwest Virginia. He lived in Vance's home for 6 months and taught as a visiting professor at Virginia Tech. This was his first visit to America. During this time, Vance broached the subject of creating Tsampa's lineage painting to capture his prominence and expertise in his culture's preservation. In Tsampa's world, this kind of painting happens when an individual reaches a spiritual and social status so significant and undeniable that his example becomes historic. At first, he demurred, but Tsampa had been observing Vance.
I first met Jane in Kathmandu, but then when I went to America, I stayed in her home, and we were in the same house for many months and became like family. And she came to know about all the different areas of knowledge I have in detail. At this time, I also got to see all of Jane's skills, what knowledge and quality she has, and the great skill she has in painting.
The painting is called Amchi. It took 10 months to complete, from the time Tsampa helped stretch and nail the linen onto its double-braced spruce frame to the moment in 2002 when Vance cleaned her brushes. Amchi joins the Tibetan tradition of lineage paintings, which situate a great teacher in a long line of their great teachers, much as a genealogical chart places an individual within a family. The painting is also a narrative record of Tsampa's first visit to America. According to his wishes, the painting includes numbered text bubbles in bright balloon colors. In them, three scripts, Tibetan, English, and imagery, explain the story of Tsampa Ngawang. Who is this man? Who were his teachers? What are his contributions? And how is he linked to America? Many elements of the painting are traditional. Tsampa is seated centrally before a prayer table. He's surrounded by a landscape of snow lions and rivers. The ritual implements and the long book on the table are specific to his tradition, as are the burgundies, marigold yellows, and burnt oranges of Himalayan Buddhism. Other elements are surprising. Tsampa once told Jane Vance that it's very important to be near flowers, and that even the thought of a flower makes your mind sharper. Vance has included the flowers of her own Blue Ridge Mountains in this setting, and the irises, Virginia bluebells, tulips, pansies, lilacs, and apple blossoms prosper in the presence of this Tibetan teacher. Amchi could only have been painted by an American who loves her native ground and has also crossed the world to find herself at home in Tsampa's culture. The Amchi painting is a portrait of a man, but it's also a record of a spiritual landscape beyond conflict. So how is it that an American artist can participate in such an elaborate and seemingly alien tradition?
Well, if you would take away the outer appearance, which is all the Tibetan and Nepalese accoutrement, it would be very surprising that this little person does these big, huge paintings that are so exotic and seem to belong to another time and place in a certain kind of way. You would have to wonder where it came from. And if I were going to be totally outrageous, I would say it's one of the few times that anything has allowed me at least tentatively to believe in reincarnation or past life experiences or something, because in a way it seems so totally unlikely. It seems to be authentic. I mean, I don't think anybody could fake something like that, because it's stunning and it's spectacular and it's gorgeous and it is powerful. And when it is put into this ceremonial context, it becomes even more engaging and alluring and exciting.
One of the noticeable characteristics of my work is probably the level of detail, or maybe the level of vibrant color, or the number of shapes, you could say. I think it's like my particular fight against poverty of the imagination. You have to take a long time to build a rich and beautiful place. But I've always known you could, and it's a matter of calm faith and the desire to show how gorgeous a space can be, or how exhilarating but calm a way of being is when you persist. This is the last moment of Tsampa being upright in this country for the rest of time, for the millennium. Travel well, Tsampa love.
In the spring of 2007, after years of planning, the painting was finally taken off its stretchers and rolled up like a medieval scroll. The Virginians were preparing for their departure to escort the painting to its new home far away. The first stop on their journey was Kathmandu, a city that's long served as the gateway for Himalayan mountaineering expeditions, trekkers, and spiritual seekers. As the team from Virginia completed the long flight, Nepalis were expecting their arrival. When the plane touches down, Tsampa is there to greet them. After bestowing traditional blessing scarves upon one another, the team gathers their belongings, including one special bag containing the painting. Luggage is tied down to the van, and then, welcome to the streets of Kathmandu. Chaos, clamor, and congestion. And then to the serene garden of the Kathmandu guest house. It's here, after 30 hours of travel, that the painting opens its eyes in its new country. For the first time, the painting and the man in the painting meet. The bridge between two cultures, mostly strangers to one another, begins to show. The painting is not yet home, but it's a relief that it's arrived in Nepal undamaged. Until it receives its frame, the painting is incomplete. The team walks the long linen scroll to a traditional Himalayan painting shop, expert in stitching it to a heavy museum-quality silk brocade. The fabric's proportions and colors must be discussed at length. The negotiations aren't about price, but about how to achieve harmony and honor the intent of the painting. And these Tibetan paintings, called thangkas, this rich cloth frame, finishes the work. The frame will be made of fabric from the famous silk mills of Varanasi, India, where the most vibrant brocade in the world is produced. Every painting shop in Kathmandu trusts only its own special simkong, or tailor's house, with this costly material. The gift is now in the hands of the tailor. Thangkas are sacred art, recognizing that inspiration is a crucial part of spiritual progress. The deities in the paintings, so foreign to Western eyes, are actually enlivened aspects of your own potential, each of them opened and then revealed through commitment and practice.
This part I also love.
Jane Vance is an unusual visitor to the Thangka shops in Kathmandu because she's painted many of the gods and goddesses herself back in Virginia.
Sir, there's a word.
All of the arts in Nepal, even when they appear decorative, are practical. What looks improvisational or fanciful at first is actually informative. Fierce expressions on a mask aim their menace only at one's weaknesses, frightening old bad habits away. Color combinations in hand-spun, hand-loomed weavings symbolize elements such as water or fire, which in turn remind the viewer to be resourceful or dedicated. The transformation from slippy mud to reliable water-bearing vessel reenacts a parable about transforming an undisciplined mind into a proper vessel. And a master jeweler's creations.
This is the highest quality.
Carry old medicinal and spiritual associations in their stones. All of these arts make the entire Kathmandu Valley a living museum, an unending service of invocations and instructions patiently whispered in every detail.
What Nepal can really give is it can open the eyes to a lot of foreigners. Eyes, they can open their hearts out, they can open their mind, you know. So this is one thing that we can really share. Just coming to Nepal and seeing the people here being happy with a fraction of what you have. And you can go back and you can appreciate what you have and you can be a little more happy than what you were before you visited Nepal.
After several days in Kathmandu, the team is called back to see the tailor's results. The framed thangka covers the entire floor. The shop owners understand completely the drama of this moment. The protective cover and fabric frame allow the thangka to roll up and tie easily to the back of a saddle to be transported to different villages for religious and festive occasions. For centuries, the unveiling of enormous thangkas featured prominently in the cultural life of old Tibet and Nepal. Until today, no shop in Kathmandu can remember any similar job, so large and layered and lavish. With the framed thangka safely installed in a protective plastic pipe, now it's time to head west to Tsampa's village of Jomsom on the edge of the Himalayan high country. The twin-engine plane lifts like a hummingbird, threading between rock faces of 26,000-foot peaks, Annapurna and Dalgaru. Team member Jason Swan, on his first trip to Nepal, expresses how it feels to disembark from that harrowing flight. The painting seems instantly at home and ready to explore the village. Joey, the youngest member of the American contingent, accepts his first blessing scarf as if he's accustomed to a lama's welcome. And the painting is carried to the Dancing Yak, Sampa's home, which also serves as a hotel, medical center, and monastery.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Okay. Rice.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Good luck.
Throw.
Good signs.
Thank
you.
In the 6 years since Jane Vance last traveled to Jomsom, much has changed. Cobblestone streets take the place of old dirt roads. Motorcycles and tractors are beginning to replace horses and pack animals. But much remains the same. Because of the arrival of telephone service in Jomsom, Tsampa knew of the tragedy of April 16th in Blacksburg soon after it happened, and he immediately went into prayer to help ease the suffering of the victims and their families. After teaching at Virginia Tech, Tsampa has a connection to the university, and the shootings affected him deeply. When the team arrived in his village, Tsampa knew that the first order of business was to host a ceremony to echo the candlelight service held by thousands of people back in April on the Tech campus. The names of the fallen are read by Sampa's son, Sewang, and by videographer Jenna Swan, herself a Virginia Tech graduate.
We remember Virginia Tech with love and prayers from Nepal.
Ross Almadine, Jamie Bishop, Brian Roy Blum,
Ryan Stack Clark, Austin Cloyd, Jocelyn Couture Novak, Daniel Perez Sueva,
Kevin Granata, Matthew Gwaltney,
Caitlin Hammerin, Jeremy Herbstritt,
Rachel Hill, Emily Jane Hilshire, Jared Lane,
Matthew Laporte, Hen Lee,
Liviu Librascu, G.V. Loganathan,
Partahi Lamban Turuan,
Lauren Ashley McKen, Daniel Patrick O'Neill,
Juan Ortiz Ortiz,
Minal Panchal,
Aaron Peterson, Michael Poli, Julia Pride,
Mary Karen Wade, Rima Samaha,
Waleed Sha'alan, Leslie Sherman,
Max Shelley Turner, Nicole Regina White,
Cho Sung Wei,
and all the wounded, frightened, heartbroken, and heroic, and the huge Hokie family all over this small, beautiful world, from the mighty Himalayas to the Appalachian and Blue Ridge Mountains of Virginia. We will always remember with you, our brothers and sisters and friends. Namaste.
Before the festival to unveil the painting, the group heads out of Jomsom village to trek for 12 days up and down canyons and mountains in the desolate high-altitude crenellations of Upper Mustang. Led by Tsampa and accompanied by a government-sanctioned guide and porters, they walk and climb for 155 miles. The farther they go, the more removed they are from the changes sweeping the region. Upper Mustang appears much the way that nearby Tibet did before the arrival of the Chinese, and the way of life there is still largely unchanged.
In Upper Mustang, I really was conscious that I was in some of the most remote land left on this planet. We saw the pits dug in the ground where people grind arid rock into silty powder, which mixed with water is those people's paint. And I was fortunate to bring back packets of this dry, incredibly intense rock dust and mix with clear, transparent oil paint, like clear toothpaste, and make paintings. One of the reasons for our pilgrimage was to go to what Tsampa calls the power places of Upper Mustang. Getting to the Padmasambhava cave was another escalator beyond your imagination. It's in a rough valley. When you walk the pilgrimage that we walked with our friend Tsampa, you hear the history of the walk. And where the monasteries are depends upon what happened in what we would call mythological time. So walking in Mustang is not just topography, it's story, and it's psychological, spiritual story.
The team reaches the meditation cave of Padmasambhava. In the 8th century, Padmasambhava came from India to this place, and Tibetan Buddhists revere his work, which was to convert and transform rather than to annihilate the wild forces inhabiting the primal cliffs and treacherous paths of ancient Tibet. Today, an old monk tends this cave. He's left his post only once in 17 years when no pilgrims had arrived for so long that he began to starve to death. The team offers rice to the unseen beings and provisions to the hermit before heading back down the path on their way to the cave of the snow leopard.
Just months before we went to Nepal to deliver our gift, on the front page of BBC News, there was a story about a cave being rediscovered after 1,000 years in the remote west of Nepal. And at that time, I had no way of knowing that our team would be the third group of climbers to reach that cave. Now, the first team that went rappelled down, and it was so named the Cave of the Snow Leopard when Luigi Fini, the climber and the restorer and our friend, rappelled down, hanging on the side of that cliff, and saw only the padded tracks of a snow leopard and the mark of its tail dragging in that silty earth. That work in that cave is, I think, unprecedented in all the world. And I was peculiarly prepared to see it, because I had lived for a year on the island nation of Sri Lanka, where the great tradition of cave art is not like even 22 miles across a bit of ocean, the great art of the caves like Ellora and Ajanta in the south of India. Sri Lankan art is peculiar to Sri Lanka. And there I was, in the highest mountains in the world, and I saw lines from the hand of a Sri Lankan painter, which means to me that someone from Sri Lanka 1,000 years ago walked 2,000 miles to this cliff and painted the hairstyles and flora and fauna of that equatorial island with the Tibetan Buddhist hand implements and gestures and ritual implements of only Himalayan masters. So the equator met the highest mountains in the world in a story we don't know much about.
Adding rocks to a cairn at the top of a pass, the team sees its route. The walled fortress village of Lomontong is a rough oasis in a barren surround, difficult to access. Farmers here struggle to irrigate, plow, and protect their staple food of barley. And seeing a foreigner around here is still unusual. The climax of the long walk is an audience with the king of Western Nepal, Raja Jigme Parwar Bista, who lives in an old palace. He's informal in his windbreaker and cap, and interested to hear the purpose of the visit. Over tea and Danish cookies, he learns news the old way, through word of mouth.
I really like the tradition in old Nepal of very accomplished people respecting each other's work. I like that Tsampa would know it was dutiful and polite and elegant for us to walk 155 miles, to explain in detail, patiently and softly, to the 25th hereditary king of Lo and the last of his kind, what our gift was, and for the king to understand exactly the etiquette of hearing about a gift. I like that kind of belonging.
Just outside the king's stony pueblo palace, the Lobas are building a new school. The school is a resource that they've craved for years, but its construction will be slow. This work steals the farmers from their fields, but the king knows that the people here are parched for education. Here, children will learn Tibetan, a language hanging on and threadbare in exile. Only small monastic corners now serve as classrooms where young students, side by side, commit to memory what they chant, a different passage, a different prayer. As change comes, even to this remote part of the world, not all of the old ways are lost.
What survives in Mustang is also really glorious and is truly a little time pool of what Tibet used to be.
Tibetan vitality shows in solitary places. Reliquaries from quieter centuries are restored, and ruined chapels are repaired by generator light. These days, the artists are no longer lineage masters, but field workers, barley farmers, trained in the rudiments of color mixing. Although they're in partial ruins now from melting snows, a half millennium ago, the great monasteries in Lo were flourishing. Their walls were covered with detailed mandalas, circular designs that represent a bird's-eye view of a palace. Inside the palaces, compressed into these old walls, are the great, subtle teachings about what dies and what cannot die. Culturally Tibetan, life in the west of Nepal is poor and rich, impossible and adaptive.
It's pretty humbling when you see how hard they work, how little they get from it, and when you see also that our way of life and the global warming that we have caused has caused the melting of the glaciers in Mustang, beginning in the early 20th century. They've melted back and back and back. And so the Lobos have lost more than half of the irrigated land that they had 100 years ago. So their culture is being destroyed by our hairspray. And that's a really, really sad thing.
On the edge of the high-altitude deserts of the Himalayan rain shadow, water is not an easy resource. Fresh glacial runoff springing up from the mountains at 14,000 feet is so vital that it's channeled through 108 bronze spouts at the holy site of Muktanath. At its origin, water is worshipped. Starting from these shrines, the water slams through tree trunk castings, and in the last decade or two, through hand-chiseled and hand-troweled concrete and stone channels. Taming water means harvesting rocks from riverbeds at the bottom of ravines and hauling in concrete and spools of plastic tubing from a town 10 days and 8,000 feet down trail. These troughs direct water into villages that depend on it for their very survival. The water improves the life of everyone it passes. Small mills are powered day and night to pulverize barley. A herd of goats jockeys and drops to its knees for the very same water. Without this irrigation, no crop can grow. But because the water is plentiful, a barley crop may be followed by buckwheat, even in the same season. And with water for the fields, pack animals can graze and stay healthy. Eventually, public spouts are built, practical and convenient for washing grains and clothes and children. But even with the advent of water delivery systems, water is still remembered as sacred and still serves to power the turnings of the Buddhist prayer wheels. Their time in Lo now over, the team begins the long walk back to Jomsom, where a festival awaits. First light is sleepy blue on the cobbled slates of Main Street. Tomorrow is the festival of the gift for the village. And though changes are coming to Nepal, this is a celebration, a renewal of the old ways. Jomsom women chase the night's dust from their doorsteps.
The gift happened long before the festival. The preparation was so exciting. Everyone knew who we were, knew what we were there to do. It really started days before the festival. People came in from remote villages to prepare. The dancers arrived and started practicing. The goods were brought in from the fields. All the field workers were so excited to hear this festival was going on, and they would stop in every morning at the Dancing Yak to see if we needed fresh vegetables to prepare for the ceremony.
Lila, very nice to meet you.
all the women in the village showed up to cook for days. The men all got together and prepared the meeting hall and set up speakers and chairs. The gift isn't really what we are taking to the village, but the exchange that happens when you go to a village and you share an experience with people, two cultures meeting in Nepal.
In preparation, new prayer flags will hang, printing the air with fresh blessings. Tsampa prepares the ink using shoe polish and the charred bottom of a burned pot. Pressing the cotton on a wooden block that he himself carved 44 years before when he gouged out thousands of minuscule reverse Tibetan letters. In ever windy Jomsom, the breeze will move through the printed prayers and carry the good wishes out into the festival morning for everyone. The Jomsom women fortify with strong tea. Today, they'll knead massive quantities of dough, but always while laughing and catching up on the news. Puris are flatbreads that inflate when they're fried. And hundreds of golden puris fill the length of children's beds in anticipation of tomorrow's crowds. Some of the men are kneading smaller, colored droplets of flour like Play-Doh. These tiny, moist spheres replicate the five colors of the prayer flags and serve as norbus, wish-fulfilling gems, to ornament the lips of offering cups that will be used in the ceremony. Old Buddhas are dusted, new candle wicks are twisted. The blessing table's objects are now ready. While the women continue to prepare the feast, some of the Virginians join the men in a morning archery competition. To the locals, skill with a bow is highly prized and is accompanied by friendly wagers. After seeing a perfect bullseye, today feels very lucky. Everyone in the village is preparing. Tsampa and his wife, Karma, have provided the team with gifts of traditional clothing. And Joey and Sampa's granddaughter, Yangchen Lamo, raised half a world apart, are instant friends. The ornate gowns of Sampa's twin brothers require a committee to assemble. The team photographer takes family photographs. Where there's no cathedral, where bells do not peal from a tower, a live drumbeat calls the village to gather. And then the festival procession down Main Street of Jomsom Village at last begins. As useful as modernization will be as a faster pace happens to Nepal, today Tsampa's red motorcycle sits out the ceremony. Amid prayer scarves, snow-capped midsummer mountains, and liberated milk cows, the Amchi painting follows the Buddhist flag. The procession winds its way through the village and ends at the community meeting hall. Until now, none of the villagers but Tsampa has seen the painting, and curiosity is high.
The festival that Jomsom gave us was grand and beautiful, and it took so much work. Festival preparations took days. I felt at home to be part of it. I was thrilled to see a minister of parliament, politicians, lamas, old lamas who had meditated in caves in Tibet with Tsampa's father. I was thrilled to see the mix of people who came to receive the gift and to give back their hospitality and their appreciation and their words and their dances and their food. It is great to be part of a festival in Nepal.
Tsampa's mother lights the first candle to bless the future of her son's painting. Karma Chudin, Tsampa's middle daughter, has traveled down from her nunnery in the higher mountains to play the horn. It's an old custom to take the blessing from an object by placing it onto your forehead. Hundreds of Amchi Thangka photographs are now distributed so that each guest can take home a copy. Then the MC officiates, the dancers celebrate, beginning with an arc of the mother's circle, arm in arm, stomping, not unlike that of Appalachian cloggers.
To our knowledge, this Thangka marks the first time in history that a Westerner and a female has been granted permission to do a lineage painting and life narrative of such an important Tibetan Buddhist Lama as your Amchi Dr. Tsampa Ngawang.
The different dancers have walked in from distant villages, bringing a mix of styles and songs to the stage. Curious children who may not have seen these dances before peer from behind curtains. Father and son are on stage, and Tsampa's wife, Karma, elegant in her river pearl headdress, looks on with measured pride. She sits with a powerful mother group, with whom she's cooked and prepared for days. Crowding the window ledges are school children, released to take in the festival. The audience enjoys translated speeches and dancers with red-fringed Mongolian hats and overlong sleeves, locally dyed aprons and felted woolen boots, and more dances. Hundreds of blessing scarves are presented to Jane, Tsampa, Jenna, and to Karma. And the curried vegetables and breads are finally served to hundreds of friends. For a few moments, the festival feels a little more American, like a 4th of July picnic or a state fair.
When I first visited Jane's house and saw her paintings and her work and understood that she was really painting about Nepal and another culture, I was thrilled because for me it was a way to learn about a place I had never been to. And the first time I traveled to Nepal, I realized how accurate and how informative and how much her paintings had to teach. Going with her this time to deliver a painting was amazing, because to take a painting about Nepal to Nepalese, that's quite a critical audience. And they honored her and honored her painting, and it was beautiful. I saw how accurate her work is and how careful and how detailed and how people understood what she was trying to do and understood her stories and appreciated the efforts of an American artist to bridge these two countries, these two cultures. So the festival for me was thrilling because I saw Jane being honored and I saw Tsampa being honored for all these people who have known him as a doctor and a healer and a farmer. They honored Tsampa, they honored Jane. It was great days of celebration for two wonderful people, and it was fantastic.
Outside the dancing yak, villagers bring their best horses for the traditional celebratory game of kata racing. The idea is to pick up a blessing scarf from the ground while on horseback and moving at a fair speed without falling off. Eric Pouries, with his American frame, dwarfs the local horses, and his playful attempt at the game gets the biggest applause. After dozens of attempts, one determined rider succeeds. The painting presides over the main room in its new home at the Dancing Yak, and the village begins to make plans to build a permanent home to house it in a Tibetan school that Tsampa will construct. The Amchi painting is home.
I once learned that in Tibet there is a phrase that means a painting that takes at least a year to complete. When I learned that idea, I was elated because I love the notion of slowing down and of staying. Staying and persevering and being incredibly detailed and diligent and skilled. My paintbrushes have three hairs. My paintings are the size of king-size mattresses. I want to make the excruciating, beautiful, infinitesimal detail that I see in all great relationships. If it's best friends, if it's Tibetan Buddhism and the old heart stories of the Blue Ridge Mountains, I want to make that delicate network and show it with as much respect as I know how. That's what my paintings are trying to do.
Festival day winds down. The women enjoy a well-deserved late-night meal. And the village sees its first game of Twister. A long bridge now joins cultures and spans generations, and the exchange of gifts has really just begun.
Yes. Pacific, very good.
Hey.